That we just listened to was the original version of a twist done by Hank Ballard in the Midnighters. And the man that I'm sitting with was on that song as part of the Midnighters. This is Abdul Bin Assad. We're in the south side of Cook County, Illinois, southwest of Chicago, at his home. And you knew Abdul by a different name back in the early 1950s.
Lawson Smith.
And you sang on that song, The Twist.
There's a whole history behind that that you really need to know.
And that's why we're here. Because we came to visit him for the truth, the history, and the actual fact of how The Twist came about. But let me find out how you came about. Take us back to the beginning, when you first began to sing. What city were you living in?
When I first began to sing, I was starting singing when I was a child. My mother was an accomplished musician. In fact, she played, accompanied Marian Anderson. I don't know if you know who that is. She accompanied Marian Anderson when she was in college in Oberlin, at Oberlin.
Your mother went to Oberlin back in Ohio?
Yeah, and she formed her own jazz group. And so, quite naturally, I was the only child in the family that sang. And I started singing. At that time, I had a very high tenor voice. You can see my voice is all messed up. I got chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, which they claim is incurable. And I just found out a couple of days ago you can cure this thing. But that's another story altogether. So my beginning singing was as a child. It has something to do even with The Twist. Because see, when I started singing, I was solo as, 5, 6, 7, 8, 10 years old, singing in the churches.
Which church were you singing in?
Well, I don't even know the name of the churches. It's in Detroit, Michigan.
What part of Detroit did you grow up in?
Well, we moved around back during that. You're talking about during the Depression era, and you're talking about even after, during the war years, and I remember, we lived on McDonald Street. I was about 3 or 4. I started school there, grade school, kindergarten. And then we moved to Northfield. And then we moved to the east side, to Cameron. Anyway, the thing is that we moved to different neighborhoods. My father had a problem. You understand? He didn't like neighborhoods predominantly black. So I never went to a black school. I never had a black teacher, you know, and Detroit was what you would call somewhat of a liberal city at the time. Detroit, Harlem, New York, similar. Detroit is a musician's town in the first place. So when my father married my mother, she was still in college, and he was himself an engineer. So they moved to Detroit because my grandfather, boy, this is a terrible thing to say. He sent my mother to college because of her musicianship. And when she got married, he didn't want her to get married. So it's a threat now against my father and my mother. So they moved on to Detroit, you know. And from there on...
Now, when they were married, were they living in Oberlin?
They married. I don't know if they married in Oberlin or if they married in Detroit. On my father's side, he came out of what you would call... A lot of people don't believe this. There's a town in West Virginia called Pawpaw, West Virginia, and it's predominantly this tribe of Indians. I got all the pictures, photos, everything. My great-great-grandmother lived to be 119 years old. She Cherokee, we were in the Blackfoot, you understand, we were Blackfoot from the Blackfoots of the Cherokee Nation. And she was married to a Caucasian. Now, somewhere down through there, somebody black got married in there, because you got, in my father's family, you got, they're all mixed, they're mixed up, but none of them look like, most of them look like Indians. My great-grandmother refused to move into a house when they built a house, and they got pictures of her. She's still wearing those garments that the skins and stuff, and kept her tent. I mean, it's and she was over 100 years old in these pictures.
So you're saying you've got more Indian background in your family than you do African American?
No, I got just as much of each. My father was on the Indian side. Now here's the problem. When my father married my mother, the family ostracized him for marrying a Negro or black woman,
yeah,
come with it from a slave background. So there was a problem there. You understand? On my mother's side, my grandfather was disgusted with the fact that she got married. It wasn't an approval thing coming from him. So for years, that ostracization with that my father's side, it didn't exist with his sisters and brothers, but it exists with the other members of the family. And that went on up until about 30, 40 years ago, when they finally got all that stuff, you know. On my mother's side, the whole town, that Dublin, Virginia, where she was born and raised, that whole town was actually, I guess it must have came off the same plantation and whatever. But my grandmother was given, and my grandfather was given this property that had this nice house, had acreages, quite a few acreages, acres, with had animals, you know, and this, that, and the other, and orchards and farmland and so on and so forth. And my grandfather, sad to say, he was what they call the, I can't even think of the term right now, but the one who usually has the whip and the gun to drive the people that's working in the field.
Slave master?
No, he wasn't slave master. The slave master, that was after slavery. But they still carried on this slavery type thing. So most black people at that time was working in the fields, so on and so forth. So he was authorized to shoot and kill anybody that wasn't carrying their load, so on and so forth. And he was a cruel taskmaster. Now they moved to Detroit. My father...
What year they moved to Detroit?
I don't know. I wasn't even born.
Before you were born. What year were you born?
I was born July 3rd, 1931. But I can almost remember, I know from 2-3 years old, I can remember almost everything. I don't know why. I remember even when I first started school, they never cut my hair because it was what black folks call good hair, which is, I don't know where they get that from, because it wasn't really nappy, it was curly. But my mother never cut it because it was real long, so I had longer hair than my sisters. And so I don't know the difference between a boy and a girl. I got 5 sisters. And my mother, my nickname was Boy. That was to let her know that I'm different from them. You know, and then I had a sister younger than me, used to beat me up every day. So when I went to school, the day before I went to school, my mother cut my hair. They had to hold me down, because I didn't want her to cut my hair. And so we went to school. When I went to school, the teacher separated us. She said, the boys over here and the girls over there. Say the girls are sugar and spice and everything nice, and boys are puppy dog tails. So I came home, and my sister going, I'm going through the daily ritual. I'm getting ready to get my whipping from her. I told her, you can't whip me. I'm a boy. And then I put an end to all of that. That's daily ritual, because I had this high tenor voice, you know. But my father being so prejudiced toward black people, here's the thing he told me, and I never forgot it. He said, never trust a nigger. He said, if you want something done, do it yourself. Now, the one first part was true, but the second part, that's not true. If you want something done, try to find somebody that you can orchestrate. You know, in other words, you got to work with people.
Yeah.
See? So, but that was his philosophy. And that's why we constantly move, one of the reasons anyway, that we constantly move.
So what you're saying is you stayed out of the black neighborhoods.
Well, there really wasn't no strong black neighborhoods at that particular time. Neighborhoods in Detroit were pretty well mixed. But the neighborhoods we moved in, like the last neighborhood we moved in to was Highland Park, Michigan. Highland Park, Michigan had that was predominantly Caucasian. And especially the black, but it was transitioning at that particular time.
Now that's where Bill Haley from, yeah. Bill Haley and the Comedy.
You had this great high school that had junior college, and you got 2 years of junior college free when you graduate. That's how Highland Park was the ideal inner city suburb, you know. It sit right in the inner city. So all of my friends were Caucasian for years there. And then as the transition came about, that's when I started singing with this. We had put this brand new African American church about three or four blocks from on the same street. We lived on LaBelle, the African American Episcopalian, because I think my mother was Baptist. But anyway, I was in the choir, and they formed a quartet of the children. Well, we weren't children. I was a teenager then. There was me, Freddie Pride, who was one of the originals in the group before it even got into anything, and a couple other fellows. And that's when I first ran into the real writer of the twist.
Who was that?
His name was Nathaniel. I can't think of Nate's last name. But he was with the Nightingales.
Where'd you meet him?
We were singing, we had a very good group. And you had the Five Blind Boys, the Soul Stirrers with Sam Cooke. Sam was just a little kid. The Soul Stirrers, you had the Nightingales. And we were on that same show with these big time religious groups. And that's when I met Nate. And so one thing led to another years later, because that group, the only one that survived did it and came a part of the Midnighters, even though Freddie Pride, originally, I took his place in the group. The group was just forming, and Freddie went and joined the army, and he told the fellas, he said, look, get Lawson, he can take my place. He went and joined, he got into the paratroopers, so that automatically opened a spot for me. So when the group had not really got formed at that particular time, this is that group. This was the bass singer. Now these three people, that's me there. This is Charles. He was the one that did Moonrise, and Henry Booth. This fella here, Rufus was his name. Sonny Woods took his place. Sonny Woods is this person. Sonny. Sonny took his place, and these three with Sonny were the ones that signed the contract with King Records. Because Johnny Otis got us a contract with King Records that we would do his song. We had run this amateur show, a theater in Detroit. They had all the shows like the Apollo in New York. We were on it. We won first prize. Little Willie John and people like that would win. So we won first prize. Johnny Otis was playing there, where he had these two stars, Johnny Walker and Little Esther. Two had hit records, and Johnny Otis had this big band with hit records. And Johnny Otis had written this song, Every Beat of My Heart. And he liked the way we sang, so he asked us to come up to his room, and he said, look, if you agree to do this for me, he said, I'll see that you get a contract. with King Records, which we ended up on Federal, which is a subsidiary to King. He said, I'll see that you get a contract. So we said, okay, we agreed, but he became the manager of the group. So we set up, we cut four sides. We did Moonrise, Every Beat of My Heart. Every Beat of My Heart hit, but the problem was the record company went on strike, and that killed the record. And that's when, years later, Gladys Knight and them, they covered exactly the same way. They didn't change nothing.
That was in 61. That was 1961. Yeah. What year did you do it?
We did it in 1952. 51.
Okay.
1951.
And did you do it there on Brewster Avenue at the old ice house?
Yeah. We did it because at that time, you didn't have these studios. You had to go to the record company.
Right.
And they had the studio, and they even did all the records and everything right in there. But King Record Company had the biggest distribution across the country than any other label. Chess wasn't even on the map at that time. Chess didn't even exist. And when we did that, Chess came along in the mid-50s. Now, when they get to the twist, that's part of the history.
Right.
They don't know that Leonard Chess, we did it, the twist for him. The problem with it was this. We had stopped recording for King Record, for Federal Label, because we didn't want to do any more things, and we signed a contract with Leonard Chess. And Chess was the hot thing at that particular time in I think that was about 1957, 58. We did it in Miami, Florida.
Henry Stone.
Leonard, when he got the master, he called Sid Nathan, the owner of King Records, and told him, look, I got your Midnighters. And he said, look what I'm, my first release. And he played it over the telephone. Only problem was, King Records had a 30-day option on the contract. So we signed the contract before the 30-day option. The contract was over. So King was going to let it lapse. There was one day left on the option when he played it on the telephone. And when he played it on the telephone, Sid picked up that option. Nate, when he first wrote it, he went to the Spaniels. And he asked the Spaniels to do it. The Spaniels said, no, we can't. That's too suggestive. We can't do that kind. Why don't you take it to the Midnighters? Now, we've known out there the Nasty Boys. It's suggestive stuff. You know, Work With Me, Annie. Annie Had a Baby. Sexy Way, She's the One. All Night Long. Get it, you want to see you with it, and all that kind of crazy stuff. So there we were, they wouldn't even play our stuff on the radio. That's why all of it was hitting. And we dominated the charts. We had, in 1954, we had four records on the chart, 1, 2, 3, 4. And they would just switch places, back and forth, for over 6 months, you know.
Because your records weren't being played on the radio, but they were being played in jukeboxes.
Well, they started playing,
and people were buying the records.
The records were selling like hotcakes.
Yeah.
Just because they, you know, now some DJs started playing because people started demanding. You know, so
Alan Freed, he started playing.
Now, Annie, the thing about Annie Had a Baby, that wasn't written. That was written by Henry, the A&R man for King Records.
Henry Glover.
He actually wrote it, because when we put out Work With Me, Annie, Henry Glover, since it hit, at that time when it came out, we were the Royals. The King Records had the Five Royals, which was a big group back then. They had all these hit records. Okay, the only thing the Royals had was Get It, which hit, Get It, You Don't Want to See You With It. But that had a couple of years had passed, and then Hank wrote Work With Me, Annie. Okay, when Work With Me, Annie hit in 1954, we were called the Royals, and then you had the Five Royals. They saw that this was going to be a smash hit. So right away, after about a couple of weeks, they say, well, we got to change the name of this group. because there's going to be a lot of confusion. Because we go around, people thought that we, whenever we went somewhere to play, the promoters would hire us because they'd get us cheaper than they'd get the Five Royals. And the people thought we were the Five Royals. So the king say, okay, they got these hits, this big hit coming. So they changed, they put on the label. It first came out, the Royals. Then after probably about 100,000 or so records was sold so quick, they changed, put on the label, the Midnighters, formerly the Royals. So that's the way the name Midnighters happened to come up and be changed. And that was April or May of 1954. But getting back to the twist, when they took it to them, the Spaniels, they said, no, we can't do it. Take it to the, maybe the Midnighters to do it. So we were playing Tampa, and these spiritual groups were appearing in Tampa, and we were staying in the same hotel. And I was walking down the hall in the hotel, and Nate saw me, and he said, Lawson, he said, look, I think I got a tune for y'all. You understand? He said, so I went around his room, and he did this thing. I say, man, that thing, I say, it's got nice beats, got nice everything, but we got to change some of the lyrics in there. You understand? Because those lyrics are even going beyond, you know.
It was too strong for you,
even for us.
Yeah.
So I went around to Hank, and I said, look, man, I think I got just the thing for us to break when we go from King Records to Chess. Because Chess wanted us, in spite of the fact that we had stopped recording for King. And we didn't have nothing out there, but they were still playing. In those days, they played you for years on the radio, you know. So I get Hank, and we get the guitar player, and we go around to Nate's room. And there we sit down, and we start working on changing the word lyrics. And so we took all that stuff in and out, up and down, all around, took that stuff, and changed it. The twist was still there. You understand? Come on, baby, let's do the twist. That was, all of that was Nate stuff. But then when you got into part of it, into chorus and so on and so forth, it's filth. So we just changed a few words. We got the whole band together, and we rehearsed. And so we went down to Miami to a studio to cut, because Leonard was waiting for this. We told him we had some stuff. And we go down to Miami, and I remember, after we recorded a couple of sides and the twist of one of them, Hank went back into the back office. I said, that nigga gonna steal this man's record. You understand? And sure enough, he did. And when the
record
came, how
did he steal it? What do you mean he stole it?
He put his name on there. And Nate never got any money for that. This record sold, Hank made about $1 million off of that record. You understand? Nate never got anything. They tell me that Hank gave him $100. You understand? Nate was an alcoholic, and he was on in a down spiral. And he never challenged. The Spaniels and me could have got the rights for Nate, you know, but I didn't have no animosity when I left show business. I say, to hell with this, I'm out of here. So the thing is that, and I mean, this is not, I'm not just telling you something nobody else knows. But people know about this in the history. But if there are any of the Spaniels still alive, they can tell you about it. And then there's Norman. At that particular time, Norman wasn't paying that much attention to, because he wasn't even in a room when we made the change.
Yeah, Norman said he wasn't there.
Yeah, he wasn't even in the room. But he was part of the group.
Now, yeah, but he said he wasn't there that night when
no.
you guys... Now, when this occurred, were you in Tampa?
We were in Tampa at the hotel.
What hotel? Do you remember the hotel?
It was the only big black hotel in the whole city. Back in that time, in the 50s, you had this prejudice thing.
Yeah.
You couldn't stay anywhere. I mean, that's had some reason for the influence on me jumping in following Elijah Muhammad, because I had never experienced racism. This was the best hotel you could, and it was nothing much more than a dump, but it was a large building.
Do you remember the name?
I don't remember the name of the hotel. It's on all the entertainers, black entertainers stayed there. You understand? Because that was the only really nice sized hotel that could put up with the large groups of people. And they only had that one in that particular time in Tampa. They didn't have a whole lot of different places for you to stay. So that thing about the twist, what happened when we first released the twist on Federal Records, they said it sold 750,000 copies.
Henry Stone set up a little recording studio.
Yeah. All we did, we just went in there and cut it. That was with Chess and him. Because the masters was going to Leonard Chess.
You mean this was not going to be done for King Federal? This was going to be done for Chess?
No, this was being done for Chess. Because our contract had expired with King, but King had a 30-day option. And we thought that the expedite, see, we wasn't looking at the option. We just know the contract expired.
On that day. So you were anxious to get out from that contract and go to Chess.
So, well, see, the agreement had already been made with Chess Records that we were going to be recording for Chess. So when we did the twist, the masters was sent to Leonard. Well, on that option that had 30 days, there was one day remaining on the option.
Now I understand.
And he played the twist over the telephone. Leonard Chess played it. Leonard, the owner of the Chess Records, was bragging.
He opened his mouth too soon.
One day too soon.
To Sid.
And when Sid heard it, he picked up the option.
He said, "That's mine. I want it."
See, he could pick up the option. We didn't have to sign because he had the option.
Okay. All right. Now,
so now the record went. He got the master. Ended up with King Records. Otherwise, Chess was in for a big suit. So Leonard wasn't about to put up with that. Leonard had all these hits going at that particular time anyway.
Yeah.
But he lost what he really thought he had. And here's the thing. King at that time sold 750,000 copies, which means they sold over a million. But a twist. This went mainly black because the twist went to the top of the charts. You understand? Okay, when it hit, a year or so later, Dick Clark had this, Chubby was this high school kid, you understand, and Dick Clark had him cover the twist. They did it exactly the same way we did it, you understand, it just that it had Chubby Checkers, because I remember when we first heard it over the radio, Hank thought it was ours playing. You understand?
Because when you listen to the two, it's hard to tell the difference.
Yeah. He tried to kill off the Midnighters. His whole thing was, he refused to let us be on his show. You understand? And he started promoting Chubby Checker. Okay, now, he's taking it pop. And with him playing it on the Dick Clark show, it automatically was a big smash hit. So Chubby sold 15 million copies of that thing. We ended up selling 2.5 million more copies on top of the 750,000. Now, Hank is getting money out of all of this. You understand? But Dick Clark was trying to kill off the Midnighters, and Merv Griffin, you can go get this footage from him. Merv Griffin had just started his show, and he was competing with Dick Clark's show. And so what he did, he had us appear on his first show. We appeared on the Merv Griffin show doing the twist. And if you want it, that's where you can get that some live us acting and everything. I mean, doing our whole thing on the twist on that show. Now, we showed Chubby Check how to do the twist. And we played in Philadelphia. And Chubby came by the theater. And we brought him up on stage. Now, the twist dance was not originated. The dance was not originated by the Midnighters. I don't care what Norman say. The twist dance was originated by some women out there in the audience. Because we used to do like this on stage. And you see these women out there in the audience, they're inward. So boom, we just picked that up. You know, so the dance was created really by the people who was listening to it. And it became a craze. I mean, one of the biggest things going at that particular time, but it was Chubby Checkered. Okay, but the Midnighters now was exposed. When we used to play the South, even with all that filth that we had in our records, you had, the Caucasian had to be up in the auditorium upstairs, the separation, black folks be downstairs. What used to happen in most of those situations, these teenagers, man, they hell with the law. They come down and get on the floor. You know, so you have chaos going. The police upset, everybody upset. You know, these niggas and white folks are mixing down here. This in the 50s. You ain't supposed to have none of that. See, this is not the original picture. This picture here had, he was on it, the original Midnighter picture. Charles was on it, and he wasn't on it. Cal came along, we hired Cal later on, the guitar player named Arthur Porter. His picture was on there. It's another photo. I don't have a copy. My sister and my daughter got all the history on this stuff. It just happened to be that I had this, and I thought maybe you might be interested in knowing. But this is the most popular picture, but the original picture of the Midnighters didn't have Cal on it, and it had Charles on it, and I don't know, remember if Henry was on it, because Henry was a real problem. Henry Booth.
Henry Booth.
You understand, he was a real problem. When the group broke up, we were in New York. And all of a sudden, we're in this hotel, and we're getting ready to go to the next gig. And they told us, Hankins checked out, he gone. So we ran, what the heck going on here? And took the cars and everything. And there we are, me, Norman, and Henry, up there in this hotel. And they done schemed with a thing with Ben Bart, with the booking agency, and they done set up and got another group of people, the background saying for Hank. Now the Midnighters had a whole different kind of act, and we didn't know this was going on because this Caucasian woman, multimillionaire, she had bought the management contract, and she got tired of me running around there selling this black newspaper calling white folks devils. You understand? How are you going to put up with these dumb Negroes out here up here talking about that, going around the country selling this newspaper and talking this kind of crazy talk? You know, so they said, look, we got to break this thing up. Because me and Norman, we out there, we off into this thing. I'm not a part of that anymore, you know. But I'm just saying, you couldn't expect them to keep, well, at that time when the group broke, I was getting ready to quit anyway, you know. And so, Decca Records wanted to pick up the Midnighters, and they could come up with a $6 million suit against King Record Company, you understand, over suing, me and Henry were the ones listed on the suit against King Records and the booking agency for Hank using the name Midnighters, and they trying to block us from using it. Well, I mean, the powers that be in show business, when they want to block you out, you out. You don't care what you. But me, I'm saying I'm through with it. But that's the story behind the twist.